Hey everyone, long time no see. Today I'm going to talk about RIP Felix, Tantalizer. As you may know, the Tantalizer is the latest fix for the NEC tokens, also known as Syscon Era 1001 or 1002. So, what's wrong with the usual tantalum capacitor fix? Before that, we need to understand what is NEC token. According to the official documentation, which is completely written in Japanese, it has four major properties: high capacitance, low impedance, high frequency, and decoupling. They also provide a graph comparing NEC tokens to other existing capacitors such as tantalum capacitors, ceramic capacitors, and aluminum electrolytic capacitors. Each capacitor type has an optimal operating frequency. For example, tantalum capacitors have the lowest ESR when operating between 1 to 10 MHz. As the operating frequency increases, the ESR of tantalum capacitors also increase rapidly. Basically, the NEC token maintains its optimal performance across almost all frequencies, making it the best capacitor you can find on the market. Also, if you want to overclock your PS3, you will be using a higher frequency. If you're interested, you can check this video about how to overclock your PS3. I will leave the link in the description below. Just like electrolytic capacitors which eventually start to leak, the NEC tokens also start to degrade as they age. When that happens, you get Syscon Era 1001 or 1002. Coming back to the Felix Tantalizer, since we cannot buy the NEC tokens anymore, we have no choice but to DIY our own solution. This is exactly what Felix tries to do here, combining both tantalum and ceramic capacitors to create our own NEC tokens. You might ask, where is the aluminum electrolytic capacitors? Right now, this project is only in release 0.9, so I believe there will be even more improvements in the future releases. Alright, enough talking, let's give it a try. First of all, we need to find a PS3 with Yellow Light of Death 1002. Come on, please, please, come on, turn yellow. Yes, Yellow Light of Death! Next, we need to extract the Syscon history to confirm that it is indeed 1002. If you get 3034, you need to replace the RSX processor instead. Let's tear it down and get the Syscon history. The first step is to remove the warranty sticker. To make the removal easier, it is better to heat it up before peeling it away. Otherwise, there will be a lot of nasty residue for you to clean up later. Ah, I messed up. You can see the nasty glue on the right hand side of the sticker. It's very difficult to clean it up. Alright, let's continue the tear down. If you are already familiar with it, you can skip to the next section. After removing the metal shield, we can get access to the motherboard. There are already a lot of tutorials out there teaching you how to extract Syscon history. So I will skip the detail and get to the main point. Basically, you connect this tiny chip to the motherboard. Then you connect your computer to the tiny chip. You also need to provide 5V power to the motherboard so that you can establish the communication to extract the Syscon history. After everything is ready, go to your laptop and log in to the Syscon. You can use this command to log into the external mode of the Syscon. Then type AUTH. Once you see this message, you can send commands to the motherboard to extract the error history. It is indeed 1002. But I want to see the full history instead of only one instance. To do that, we need to log into the internal mode. Use this command and do the same authentication as before. In the internal mode, you have access to more commands such as bitcount to check the usage history of the console. The command we need is ERRLOG, which provides you the full history of the syscon errors. As you can see here, this console has only 102 in the history, which is exactly what we want. So let's remove the NEC tokens. Again, you can skip to the next section if you are already familiar with the removal process. Okay, this is my first time populating a PCB. Not sure if I'm doing it right, but I think we need a Kapton tape to secure it and apply flux and solder. When everything is ready, put the tantalum capacitors on it and apply some hot air. The solder joints melt super easily. It's more enjoyable to work on a small PCB compared to the gigantic PS3 motherboard. Next, we also need to put the ceramic capacitors on the PCB. As I've mentioned in the very beginning of this video, each ceramic capacitor has its own optimal frequency. By putting different values of capacitors here, we obtain all the optimal frequencies. According to Felix's calculation, we need these ceramic capacitors. But some of the capacitors are out of stock, so I'm only able to get 3 capacitors right now. I will put whatever capacitors I have to the PCB. If I get the other capacitors in the future, I will add them later. It's so satisfying seeing the capacitors moving into their own place when the solder joints melt. Alright, I will do the same for the second tantalizer. After the SMD soldering, I want to confirm if everything works fine. But somehow, I couldn't get any reading out of my multimeter. When I measure each capacitor individually, I do get a value. So I thought there were problems with my soldering or the PCB. It took me a really long time to troubleshoot the problem. And it turns out, my multimeter is too crappy to measure capacitance beyond 1000 microfarad. I think it's time for me to upgrade my multimeter. Anyhow, let's clean up the motherboard and put the tantalizer back to the PS3. It's my first time working on the tantalizers, so I have no idea what is the proper way to solder it back. But I believe I should apply solder to the bottom side of the tantalizers. I tried putting it back to the motherboard using my soldering iron like this, but it doesn't work. Maybe I should try hot air later. I have difficulty putting the second tantalizer side by side. It seems the PCB is not well trimmed. The excessive part is blocking the second tantalizer on the right, so I need to cut them before I can put them together side by side. It took me a while to notice something, but it's too late. It seems hot air works well, so I will keep it like this. Now it's time to test the console. First, we need to put the fan back. Then, we also need to remove the Syscon extraction device. Finally, put the RF shield back and connect a power supply to the motherboard. Let's power it up and see if it works. Oh no, I think it becomes green light of death now. Oh wait, I forgot to turn on my monitor. After turning on my monitor, it finally works. Thank you so much, Felix. I'm looking around to see if I can find anything interesting, and then I found this. PlayStation Home. PlayStation Home is an online game released in 2008. Although I didn't play this game back then, there's a group of people trying to rebuild and host this game right now. They call it the Project Destination Home Online. If you're interested in it, you can look at this GitHub page. It tells you how to set up and install the game. And if you have the original game installed, you can even donate your game data so that they can rebuild it even better. Now, I'm going to fully assemble the console and extract the data. Since we're already here, so let's replace a CMOS battery. Oh no, the replacement I have does not match with the original one. There's no way for me to plug in the new CMOS battery. Never mind. Let's continue reassembling. Once everything is assembled, I install the custom firmware for PS3 so that I can install IrisMan, which can be used to extract the data of PS Home. After logging into the PS3, run IrisMan. Then go to the file browser and look for the PS Home folder. Depends on which version you have, you may find your game data in different places. After you found the folder, copy it over to your USB thumb drive. In my case, it takes almost 20 minutes to copy everything over. Then proceed to copy all folders related to PS Home. After that, go to your PC and zip all the folders you extracted. Finally, upload it to whatever file hosting service and then share it with Nagato, the project leader for Destination Home. That's it, that's how to fix Yellow Light of Death 1002 using the latest RIP Felix Tantalizer. I need to emphasize that it is not a fix for all Yellow Light of Death. If you get 3034, you will need to replace the RSX processor instead, which is a completely different fix. I'm still practicing my BJ rework. Because of my busy schedule, I might not have any updates for you guys until Christmas time. Anyhow, long live PS3 and see you next time.